All right, so we'll be all professional about it tonight. We've got an actual microphone, the blue snowball thing. I'm gonna use headphones so I can hear everything. And where's the game? There's the game. All right, and no borders. Oh, it's like we're professionals. Move this up a little bit. Do, do. Clear the border. Boom. Nope. That button. There we go. All right. So, reasonably good feedback on yesterday's video. So, what we're going to do today is there's some conversation about do we go to the moon next or do we build planes? So, I figured actually we would do both because I happen to have a plane which has the ability to go to the moon. Mind blown. But what does that mean? How do you get a plane that goes to the moon? So let's talk about that for a minute. Let's first, again, I have not prepared for this as well as I should have. Let's lower the volume of the music so that you can actually hear me. Come on. All right, so in the settings, we have, let's bring all of this down even more. All right, apply that. All right, hopefully the music is like kind of visible, but mostly you can hear me. So, let's look at a plane that we think can go to the moon. So, space plane, seven interplanetary is probably good. All right. So, this sort of plane looking thing, I probably spent maybe last year or the year before 40 or 50 hours of my life designing. There's a lot of details to learn. But what's interesting, and the reason why this is so special is that it has two different kinds of engines. And some of the engines are actually really unique and don't quite exist in the real world. But the reason why planes can't normally go to space is when you go high enough, you run out of air. And as it turns out, the engines on normal planes require air. Air comes in, put in some jet fuel, there's an explosion, generate thrusts. Grossly oversimplifying, but that's the base, right? So, you need an engine that can work without air. Normally, we call those rockets. And the reason why planes don't go to space is because if you strap rockets to an airplane, the plane gets kind of heavy. And now the plane no longer has enough power to get itself into space. If you just add more fuel and more engines, you ultimately don't get a combination which is capable of getting more space. Add more fuel, more power, but more power needs more fuel, and you go back and forth and back and forth. And you just end up with a really heavy plane that can't make it to space. Now, the way you get around this problem is you develop an engine which can do both. When it's in the atmosphere and has air, it can consume that air and operate like a normal jet engine. But when it runs out of air, it actually runs into what's called closed cycle mode, which allows the engine to run on what's called oxidizer, which is a type of fuel in addition to jet fuel, and continue to produce thrust. And so in this game, so in the real world, I believe we have engines called Spears, which are prototypes of them that can do this. Nothing full scale in production, but give it another 10, 15 years, we'll probably get there. And so I think as a pun on the spear in the game, they're called rapiers. So much for that. But these allow us to breathe air when we're in the air, and they operate in closed cycle mode when in space. So let's try and fly this a little bit. Trying to make sure I can hear myself. There we go. So, it is nighttime. Let's fix that. Let's make it daytime. And the sun comes up. And the sun's overhead. All right, daytime. So, we are going to try and get space. So you'll notice, unlike a rocket, we're going to take off on a runway. It's going to look quite a bit like a plane. Alright, so it's not super quick to speed up, but we'll see what we can do. I haven't flown this plane in months, so I might get this wrong. Let's see if we get to space. We should be able to get to space. Assuming we can get to the end of the runway. Alright, you have to quite a bit of speed. This is not a lightweight plane. And we'll pull up at the last moments, and up we go. Excellent, alright. So when the engines are in the atmosphere, they're really, really, really efficient. They don't burn very much fuel. They can run for hours. When they're in space, they can only run for a couple minutes. And so the goal of our ascent trajectory is to gain as much speed as possible while still in the atmosphere. And you can manipulate and guide your plane based on very specific properties of your engines. So you pick up speed at certain points, at certain air densities, at certain elevations and altitudes. So these engines start to pick up a lot of speed when we get about 400 meters per second. But they also start to consume more fuel there, and we're starting to go real fast, and a lot of air resistance if we do too low. So I don't want to cross 400 meters per second until we're at about 7,000 or 8,000 meters. That way the air is a little bit thinner, it's a little bit more efficient. The plane really wants to pitch up. Let's fix that. Down a bit. There we go. Alright, so we'll level out a bit. We can start gaining speed. Alright, so we're getting to level 9,000. We need to start going faster real quickly now. Alright, so we're gonna get to almost completely level. There we go. Plane still wants to pitch up a little bit, that's fine. Alright, so now we should very quickly start gaining speed. Probably get to 1,300 or 1,400 meters per second before we pitch up really dramatically and leave the atmosphere. Right, so we're staying in the atmosphere. We're at about 30,000 feet right now, which is where normal planes will cruise. So not too high up, still plenty of air. And we're gonna start to pick up speed really fast, and then we're gonna go up. So we're gonna just skip over the atmosphere, and we'll switch to closed cycle mode, so we're no longer breathing air, and use that to get us extra horizontal velocity that we talked about in our last video. So we're starting to go pretty quick. 1,000, 1,100. We're gonna pull up a bit, start to gain some altitude as we gain speed. But just start to think about leaving the atmosphere. Still gaining speed, not quite as much as we'd like. I'd like to be going a bit faster at this point. Like I said, I am out of practice at flying this plane. Just gonna watch that. 1,200. Should get to 1,300 or so before we run out of air, but I think I'm not gonna get that far. So we're gonna switch over. All right, so now we're out of air. As you see, the engines aren't really producing any thrust. The speed's going down, so we now switch over to closed cycle mode. Now we're no longer burning air. We're burning oxidizer, which is just liquid oxygen, inside the engines, and that's liquid oxygen that is stored in the tanks. And so we go up out of the atmosphere, and then we'll start going sideways even further. So we want to pitch up and get out of the atmosphere as quickly as possible now. $32,800, 33,000. $35,000. We're getting there. Almost 40,000. Now you'll notice the shock heating is a little bit less. The air is a bit thinner. This gauge up here shows you how thick the air is. So the needle is starting to get towards the other side. So we're almost in the vacuum of space. 1,800. I'm also looking up here. The apoapsis is a technical term that is the maximum height of a trajectory. So space starts 70,000. So we want to get to at least 70, 75. So maybe we'll let that get to 80, and then we'll shut off the engines. Now, as I said, burning these engines is very inefficient. So we actually have a different set of engines in the back that we just activated. These are called nuclear engines. They burn only jet fuel. They don't require any oxidizer. And this is sort of like ion technology, kind of exists in the real world. It's a little exaggerated in the game, just for the sake of making the game more playable. But as a result of not requiring any oxidizer, they take a long time to get anywhere. They're a really, really small amount of thrust, right? And so I'm starting to add horizontal velocity here very early because it's going to take a long time. And so now basically we point the plane horizontal and we just wait. And so it's going to take us probably at at least 2 more minutes, so I'm actually going to speed this up a little bit. So the other number that we're watching is our periapsis height. That is the lowest height in our orbit. So our highest height is up here, is like 80, 90,000, and our lowest is actually inside the planet. So we're waiting for this number to become positive, and when it does, that's how we know we have a circular orbit. Or at least an orbit that doesn't crash into the planet. And so we'll hopefully get the periapsis to be very close to the apoapsis, so it's roughly circular. Negative 80,000, negative 75, negative 60, negative 50, 30, 20. There we go, now it's positive, and now you can see the line is starting to come out on the other side of the planet. And so now we just wait for this to get over 70, and that way we know we're fully in space. 60 and 70, all right. Now our highest point is over 70, and our lowest point is over 70. We are in orbit, in space. And we have quite a bit of fuel left. The plane was built to go actually to the equivalent of Mars. The game has a planet called Duna, which is basic Mars, it's red. There's a thin atmosphere. It's about a similar distance away. But we're not going to go to Mars today. Today, we are going to MINS, which is this one. So the MUN, which is the moon, is an equivalent of the moon, basically, around Earth. MINMIS is further away, but is smaller. And is actually much easier to land on. And because I'm out of practice, we're going to go with one that's easy to land on today. So, the way we do this is, again, our plane's in orbit, so we can just let it do its thing. We might want to extend the solar panels, which are up here. Not the most aesthetic of designs, but, you know, it is what it is. There we go. Get rid of this. We don't need that anymore. There we go. So now we've got some whiskers on our little jet. Hey, buddy. Aren't you cute? No? No? Okay. Anyway. So, now we need to plan our trip to MINMIS. So we set it as our target, and now we plan what's called a maneuver node. And so what this does, this is a theoretical application of the engines in the future. Right, so if, in the future, I burn forward this amount, which should show me here, nope. Open that, there we go. 800 meters per second, then this will be our new trajectory. So if I extend this a bit more, we get closer and closer and closer to MINMIS. And now let's move it this way a little bit. These blue markers are our closest approach, right? So if I'm going to keep playing with this maneuver node until blue markers get very close to, and there we go. Now we have an encounter. So you see the purple, that shows us that we're going to come in what's called the sphere of influence. The sphere of influence is basically the gravity well of that particular body, right? So at the moment, we are in the sphere influence of Kerbin, or Earth. And if we follow this exact burn, then we will get into the sphere influence of MINMIS. What you'll also notice, if I tilt the view this way a little bit, our current orbit is orbiting on a little bit of an incline, right? Compared to the planet, it's not perfectly in the equator. This white one is on the equator. This one's not quite. And you'll also notice that MINMIS's orbit is also just, it's hard to see with this view, just offset from the equator as well. It's also on a little bit of a slant. And so depending on where the orbits are, our orbits and future orbits will also be on a slant. And you'll actually see our predicted orbit is on quite a big slant. And it's actually nowhere near the slant of MINMIS's orbit. This is what's called the orbital inclination. Right, because all the orbits actually happen in three dimensions. You might travel in a circle, but somebody else might have a circle. The circles might actually be in the third dimension, not aligned, which is exactly what you see here. So this dotted green line is our future orbit, as we were to go to MINMIS, and the yellow line is MINMIS's orbit. So they're off by quite a bit. Now the game has what's called patched conic, which is this future orbit, and it shows us our descending and ascending node. That's the point in our orbits where they cross each other. And so you'll see this dark, the dash green line crosses the yellow line right here. And if you want to change the inclination of your orbit, you must do it at one of this node, this descending node, or the ascending node, which will be over here. That is the most efficient way to change the plane of the orbit. And so what we'll do is, as we leave, you'll see we're kind of close. We'll tilt down a bit, and that should reduce, hopefully, or not. Yeah, it's pretty inefficient. I don't want to spend that much fuel doing that. Never mind. We'll do the orbital maneuver change later. So I'm just going to tweak the node a little bit, get a better encounter. Nope. Let's go like that. Okay. Now the ascending node is over here, and I can do a second burn later. All right. So we're going to do a first burn here, which is going to add velocity to our spaceship. So it's going to make our orbit bigger. It's going to come all the way up there. And then shortly later, we'll do a second burn, which will change the inclination of our orbit. That will allow us to get much, much closer to Minmus. So let's get to this burn. So we're going to time warp to about... let's go here. So we wait a few seconds for the ship to come around. Now remember earlier I mentioned that these engines are not very powerful. They're efficient, but they're not powerful. And so you'll see it's going to take 9 minutes of burning the engine to perform this maneuver. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually, according to the planner, we should start the maneuver in 6 minutes. I'm going to begin the maneuver exactly half the time before and half after. That way we'll spend 4 minutes burning before the exact point of the marker and 4 minutes after. That way any differences are made up. And so now we just move forward until we get to about 4 minutes. That's good enough. And we begin burning. So you see spaceship is now firing its engines. You all see the meters per second is winding down. And now we'll apply time acceleration and we'll go as quick as we can through this. The fastest you can time accelerate while burning your engines is 4x. And so it's an 8 minute burn, which means I had to kill 2 minutes of talking. I'm sorry for that. Normally we would just sort of edit this in post-processing, but I'm doing this live. Doing it live. And you'll see as we're burning, the blue line is getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And over the next 2 or 3 minutes or so, it's going to get close to and match the green line. You'll also see the apoapsis height, which we talked about earlier, is getting much bigger. Our future apoapsis is 16 million meters, or 16,000 kilometers. So we're only at 500 kilometers, so we got quite a ways to go. Notice how fast now we're moving over the planet. And so the International Space Station actually does a full orbit of the planet Earth every 45 minutes. And so you can actually, there are websites you can go to where you can look up when will a space station cross overhead and when can I see it. And if you go outside and it's a clear night, you can actually see the space station cross the sky. And you'll know it's the space station because it's going really fast. You've got about a minute or a minute and a half for it to go from one side of the sky all the way to the other. Maybe 2 minutes. It all happens very quickly. So you got to make sure your clock is nice and accurate. All right, we're getting there. About another minute of burning. Still got plenty of fuel left. Fuel will not be a problem. Let's check. Yeah, plenty of fuel. You'll see the blue line is going to start to move really quickly as we get close to the end of burn. It's the Earth effect and the way gravity works. The faster you're going, you sort of get to the edge of the pull of the planet. Small changes in velocity start to have a big effect on your future orbit. So we're getting there. Actually, let's stop right there. That's probably good enough. We have an encounter with the planet. Now, what I'm going to do is let's perform our inclination change. plan that like here to slow down. Alright, so leave time warp, plan a mover, change our inclination a bit, get closer to the planet. So now what we can actually do is there's a trick you can do in the game. We hit, where's focus view? Focus view. There we go. And now this purple line is our predicted orbit with our current maneuver node. And so I can click the maneuver node here and make changes to it, and we'll see changes in our orbit, our predicted orbit here. Now we get as close to the planet as possible. So I'm gonna go that way a bit. There we go. Boom. Now we get very nice and tight close to the planet. Now we're gonna move towards the maneuver node again, which is the blue marker on the dot. This little sphere in the middle is kind of confusing. So maybe in the middle of this burn, I will explain what that does. All right, so we're gonna watch the orange line, hopefully get closer to the purple line. So, the sphere, this is a nav ball. The blue marker, which we're currently pointed at, let's start with the orange marker. The orange marker is our spaceship, and the horizontal lanes are sort of the direction of the wings, and so we can rotate the ship a little bit. That mostly has an effect when you're in the atmosphere. When you're in space, it doesn't matter, right? So, the orange is where we're pointed. Blue marker, which we're currently centered on, is the marker we have to point at in order to execute the current maneuver. So the maneuver that we were planning for our orbits. The pink markers, which have triangles, are the, what do they call it, normal and anti-normal markers. That is 90 degrees inward and out, basically, from the direction that we're facing. We already talked last video about prograde and retrograde. Prograde is forwards, retrograde is backwards. And then we have radial. That is pointed, I guess, basically left and right. So if you're orbiting a planet, normal is up. So if this is the planet and you're rotating like this, prograde would be like this way, retrograde would be this way, normal would be this way, anti-normal would be this way, radial in would be this way, and radial out would be that way. And those markers show you where those are relative to your spaceship. So let's, now that we talked about the nav ball a little bit, and we'll have more examples of that in a few moments. But for the moment, we're just trying to try and finish this burn relatively quickly. The reason we want to get close to the planet is that we're going to need to slow down when we get there. All right, so we're just about there. A little bit closer, 300,000, 200,000. Let's get under 200,000 call today. That's close enough. So as you'll notice, so this is the trajectory that our ship will encounter, our ship will experience as we get close to... Did I target the moon? I'm an idiot. We went to the moon. Oh well. We're going to land on the moon instead of landing on Mimas. That's fine. I was wondering why that encounter was so easy. Whoopsies. Not the greatest Kerbal Space Program player. So anyways, this will be our trajectory. And you'll notice we're going to come in, and we're going to come in so fast, the moon is going to arc our orbit. It's going to affect the trajectory. But we're going so fast that we can't actually get a circle. So we have to slow down when we get there. That way, the gravity of the body that we're about to orbit is strong enough to pull us in. If we're going sideways too fast, we leave. So we need to slow down how fast we're going sideways. And the closer we do it to the planet, the less fuel we'll have to spend in order to do that, right? Taking advantage of the Oberth effect. So what we'll do is we'll plan our next move over here, and we're going to slow down. We're going to point retrograde, and that's going to slowly bring our orbit in until we have something roughly circular. That looks pretty good. Let's make sure we have fuel. Plenty of fuel left. We're good. All right, so now let's time warp to here. This is us right now. We're coming this way. We're coming toward the moon, coming towards the moon. Still not in the moon's sphere of influence. Still not there. Still not there. Almost. And now we are in the moon's sphere of influence. There we go. Now we're going to point at our maneuver node again. We have a 2-minute burn, which will happen in 18 minutes. So we'll speed up time a little bit to get closer. We also probably want to do the burn exactly at periapsis to make it as efficient as possible. So So let's go to about there. All right, and the burn's gonna happen in 3 minutes, so we need to kill 2 more minutes of time. Three, two, one, all right, good enough. And we start our burn. So now, there you go, we're at the moon. And we're pointing our engines backwards, so we're firing retrograde. So we're slowing ourselves down, see our orbit is slowing. You'll see our apoapsis is negative, which means that we are not traveling around the planet. We're actually going to leave the planet. The apoapsis is going to go so negative, it'll go to negative infinity, and then it will become positive, and that means we are trapped in an orbit around the planet. Our current orbit is a hyperbola, right? And we need to change the hyperbola to an ellipse. So, hopefully just a few more seconds of that. So, see the apoapsis is starting to get pretty big, or pretty negative anyway. Negative, oh, and now it's positive. So now we are circular. So if we stop really quickly, oh, nope, almost. Now it's circular. There we go. So that we'll get it down. 500 is fine. There we go. Now we have achieved an elliptical orbit, almost circle, around the moon. And now we're going to land on it. So remember last time we discussed, if you want to land in sci-fi video games, you just point at the body and you go in. But as we know, that is an inefficient and the incorrect way to get to the planet. We want to slow down our sideways wind. So if I did that right here, we could plan that with our maneuver node, we would land somewhere here in the dark. Right, so I'm actually going to wait until we're over here or so. That way we can land while it's daytime. So I'm actually going to do a little bit less. We'll do something like that. That's probably good. Nope, come back. So now we have to wait another 30 minutes in game time up here. Do, go there. 19, 18, 17, 16. And watch the moon go by as we time warp. We're going to have an eclipse of the Earth. The Earth is going to go by. Now we're on officially the dark side of the moon. Dun, 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 dun. But the sun is coming. We're going to sunrise over the moon. Check that out. Any second. There we go. Sun. So now we point again at our maneuver, which will be basically retrograde because we're slowing ourselves down. Go away. All right. And now we just watch our orbit. So come back. Nope. There we go, that's a lot. So we started the burn a little early, that's fine. I just want to land roughly on the light side. That's close enough. Let's go with that. Let's get the spaceship to right around here. Now we're going to start to get pretty close to the planet, or the moon, I guess. All right, now we're going to continue to point retrograde because we're going to want to slow ourselves down as we get closer to landing. Also, there's no atmosphere on the moon, so we can lower our landing gear. It's a little early, but you know, this way we don't forget it later, because we will want to land on our wheels. We also will probably want to orient the wheels so they're actually pointed down now. So we'll rotate the spaceship a little bit. Over it goes. All right, now we slow down the rotation. And stop. All right. Now we go down to the moon. So let's change our orbital velocity to be surface velocity. So as we're falling towards the moon, just like if you dropped a baseball from the top of a very tall building, it's going to accelerate, right? So since we're falling towards the moon, you'll actually see our speed is increasing. That has me a little bit concerned because remember, our engines are really not powerful. So we're going to want to slow down quite considerably long before we get to the surface. So we'll come down a bit, but we're going to start firing the engines a little earlier than maybe we'd expect to. It's going to take quite some time to remove 500 meters per second. So let's sort of keep the ship pointed that way. We're going to remove our horizontal velocity. This is a very inefficient way to land, but it is a consequence of having really underpowered engines. Right, I'm looking at the horizontal speed. To start burning straight retrograde. We need to slow down. We are falling too fast. A little bit nervous that we might crash into the surface. Let's see what happens. Yeah, I think we're going to crash into the surface. Yeah, I don't think we have a chance. No. Yep, definitely gonna hit the surface. Yep. That is what we call a successful landing. All of our Kerbins are still alive. There we go, we made it. Now we can plant our flag. Excellent. Not my best landing. Yeah, look at that. Whoops. Yeah, that's we bounced a little funny. There we go. And our jetpacks work. Right. So thankfully, because this is a video game and not real life, we have quick saves. So I don't know if you noticed, but I did a quick save while we were coming in for a landing. So we can try that a second time. So again, we'll point retrograde. Let the spaceship come around. There we go. This time we'll probably start slowing down a little earlier. Again, we have to do our rotation. All right. So let's start right around here this time. Quite a bit earlier. Let's see how we do. I think this might be a little way too early. That's okay. You can always fall and then catch up later. Better to be too early than to slam into the surface a second time. It'd be really embarrassing. Probably let's show our orbit, so graphically what this looks like. So our orbit was circular, and now we're slowing it down. I'm going to land somewhere around there. So when we get about 100, I'll cut the engines and we'll coast down a bunch. Remember last time we hit the surface at about 150, so we're already doing way better than last time. So now we'll just let the ship coast down a bunch. Getting there. 37,000 feet, 200. Hopefully we don't unscrew it up a second time. Want 70, want 60. 50. I think we're good. 130, 20. Coming down for a landing. Probably stop at about 50 and let it keep coasting. Let's start again now. Alright, slow down, slow down. You can do it. Please slow down. Please slow down. Slow down faster. Oh, come on. Don't smash into the ground again. You can do it, you can do it. 40, 35, 30. Land on the wheels. Nope. Better. We lost all of our engines, but the plane survived. One more time. I am rusty in practice. Alright. And go. Alright, now I'm gonna reduce throttle just a little bit. Try and keep it to, try and get to under 10 and hold it about there. Alright. Alright, 200 meters. Point forwards. Yep, not my best. We lost the solar panels. That's okay. Didn't need the solar panels. We made it. Alright, let's put on the brakes. Brakes. The brakes don't work so good without my gravity. Alright. Now we made it to the moon properly. Hold the brakes on. Now we can go out. Fly away. Aw, the thing crashed. Well, there you go. That's how you land the moon. Not so gracefully. Do what you can. Until next time, I'm not Scott Manley. Fly safe.